Okay, let's consider. Now we consider another system, which is of great interest. It is pendulum. So pendulum is a well-known device. It is a mass which is attached to some immobile, say, pivot by a massless rod of length L, mass M. And so this solid rod confines the motion of the mass to the circle of radius L. Now let us put the center of our coordinate at this point around which the rod is turning. So it is zero. It is the z-axis. And let us first find the equation of motion of this of the mass. Mass we consider as a point mass, so it makes sense to talk about the position of this mass. So the coordinate system is the following. X means the arc length between the lower point of the pendulum here and the actual position. So this is X. So just the length of this arc. Now it is positive when we go to the right and negative when we go when the pendulum, the mass goes to the left. Then what force acts on the mass? First of all, it is the gravity, minus mg. Now this force is the sum of two forces. We can project it on this the tangent to the circle, to the trajectory of the mass, and on the normal. Now the projection of the normal is compensated by the pull of the rod. So this does not affect the motion. So it is equal if it is, say, positive, moving directed in this direction, then the reaction of the rod direction in this direction and cancels it. But this is not cancelled, this component, and this component is the following. So this angle, let's denote this angle by alpha. And what is alpha? Alpha is x divided by L. Yes, it is the angle between the vertical radius and the radius directed to the mass. Yes, and this force F, its component along the tangent, equals minus, because directed opposite, minus mg. So this is tangent to this, this is vertical, this is vertical, this is orthogonal, minus mg sine of alpha. Yes, so this angle is also alpha. So F equals minus mg sine of x divided by L. And as a result, we have mx double dot equals minus mg sine x divided by L. Now we can divide by m and move it to the left and have x double dot plus g sine x divided by L equals 0. So this is equation of the pendulum. Okay? Again, this is equation of the form which we have already found. Second derivative is plus some function of x is 0. And here this should be derivative of the potential function u. U of x equal integral g sine x divided by L dx equals minus g L cosine of x divided by L. And so we have the following relation, the following integral or quantity which is constant. X dot square divided by 2 minus u, то есть u is minus g l cosine x divided by l equals e is constant. Yeah? Or x dot equals plus minus square root 2 e plus g l cosine of x divided by l. Now plus corresponds to the pendulum moving from left to right and minus from right to left. And if the pendulum moves alternatively right and left, then alternatively we have plus or minus. Now, first of all, if you try to use it to solve the equation, you again will have intractable integral. Square root of constant plus another constant times cosine, it is integral which is not expressed in terms of elementary functions. So it gives rise to deep studies of properties of the functions which are defined by this integral, integral dx divided by this square root. And it played a great role in the development of the function theory, but it is of little practical interest. So I think I want to do two things. First, I want to consider some approximate approach to this, and we'll have the most the simple and really useful formulas for the motion of the pendulum. It is one. And second, we apply the notions of the phase plane to study the motion of the pendulum at, as it is in the whole generality. So, first of all, I wanted to introduce one important concept. one moment. Here it is. Which is called linearization. So what is linearization? Consider this equation. X double dot plus G sine of X divided by L equals zero. As we see, this equation itself is highly complicated to solve exactly. But we know one interesting thing, that for small x, for small, let me call it, say t, x, y, no, x, sine of x is close to x. You know this. In fact, we have, can write sine x equal x minus x cubed divided by 6 plus x 5 divided by 120 minus x 7 divided by something even larger, and so on. So if x is small, say x is less than 100, then x cube you have to, it will be less than 10 to minus 6. Yes, we have to divide it, this term. This term will be even smaller, less to x to minus 10. So practically remains only this term. So with any reasonable, for any reasonable purpose, we can replace sine x by x if x is small. Now, small means different thing in different practical situations, but in any situation we can, if you have some say margin of accuracy, then you can take x which is smaller than small enough so that the error will be smaller than this margin. So if you replace sine x by x, then you have the following equation: x double dot plus j sine of x divided by l, replace it by x divided by l, equals zero. No, better to say x double dot plus g over l x equals zero. And this is a linear equation. You see, it is a linear equation with constant coefficient, so we can easily solve it. So the meaning of this operation linearization is that you take a nonlinear equation and replace it approximately with a linear equation. This is approximation is called linearization. Yes, after linearization you have a much simpler equation which you can solve, and it gives you the first approximation to solution, which can be really close to true solutions. If you have ever seen the pendulum clock, I think you can find it somewhere, at least in the movies about the old times. So a typical such clock is tall. The pendulum is long, about, say, a couple of meters, and the amplitude is very small, so it goes very slowly right and left, yes, and this x divided by l is really small, not more than 100, and so this approximation works pretty well for the clock, if it is not a special, say, astronomical clock, which should be very accurate. For astronomical clock, before we had atomic clocks and so on, there was a large industry of keeping time and keeping the accuracy and making corrections and so on. So it was a lost art of having accurate say time with non-accurate equipment. Now, okay, so we have this equation. Let us solve it. So, characteristic equation, lambda square plus g over L is 0. Lambda 1 is I square root of g divided by L. Lambda 2 is minus I square root of g divided by L. So, we find this, and so y 1 equals cosine of square root of g divided by lt equal cosine, let me, of omega t. Omega is square root of g divided by l. Y2 equals sine of omega t with the same omega. So what can be said? Omega is frequency. Frequency, the circle, no, angular frequency. So the period t equals 2 pi divided by omega equals 2 pi divided by square root of g divided by L equals 2 pi square root of L divided by g. So we see that the period grows as square root of the length of the pendulum. Have some idea how it works, let us consider the following situation. L equals 1 meter. So what is the period of oscillation of a pendulum whose length is 1 meter? G equals 981 meter per second square. So t equals 2 pi square root 1 divided by 81. Let me do it. I did not prepare it. Two times pi times square root of 1 divided by 9.81. Equals 2.006 seconds. So we 1 meter long pendulum will have the period about 2 seconds. Yeah. It looks quite feasible. If you look If you watch some movie about old time life, say English movie, and find you will certainly see there this old pendulum clock, and you will see and can estimate that it is looks close to this. Okay, so what can be done else? It is not the end, it is just beginning. So let us return to our equation, exact equation. So x double dot plus what it was, g sine x over l equals 0. It describes the motion of the pendulum. But let us consider the pendulum which is close to upright position. Yes, we can take a pendulum. Instead of this, you can raise it this way. Yes? In this case, x is close to pi times L. Yes? So this arc length is close to pi times L. So to this end, you write better x is pi times L plus y. No, it is a constant, pi times L. Y equals x minus pi times L. So for y, we have the following equation. Y double dot plus g sine x equals x is pl plus y. PL plus y divided by y equals 0. Y double dot plus g sine just a minute divided by L. P plus y over L equals 0. But sine P plus y over L equals minus sine y over L. So we have y double dot minus g sine y over L equals 0. So if y is this distance, no, say here, this is y, this arc. It is positive if it go it goes to the left, and negative it goes to the right. So y double dot minus g sine y over L is 0. Now this equation is not better and not worse than the previous one, in sense that it cannot be elementarily solved. But let us do again the linearization. So sine y over L is approximately equal to y over L. And so you have y double dot minus g divided by l y equals 0. Yes? Now in this case you have equation lambda square minus g divided by l equals 0. Lambda 1 is minus square root is g divided by l. Lambda 2 is square root of g divided by l. So we have two real values, and you have lambda equals solution y equals c1 cosine square root of g divided by l. C1 e minus square root of g divided by lt plus c2 e to square root g divided by lt. Yes? So this is a solution. But it is better, more convenient to write it in the following form. Let me introduce notation, which possibly you know, but let me introduce some useful combination. Let me introduce hyperbolic sine of x equals e x minus e minus x divided by 2. Hyperbolic cosine of x equal e x plus e minus x divided by 2. So these two combination of e x and e minus x. So this is hyperbolic cosine, it is even function, it is hyperbolic sine, it is odd function. And and then you can write y equals c1 cosine hyperbolic of square root g over lt plus c2 hyperbolic sine of square root g divided by lt. So we can write in this form. And this is more, I would say, more convenient. Now, let me draw the graphs of this function. Graph of cosine hyperbolic, it is e to the x plus e minus x. It looks like this, as it is an even function. So it is x, it is y equal hyperbolic cosine x. Sine hyperbolic is the difference. So for x equals 0, it is 0. Derivative is 1. So it is something like this. It is y equal hyperbolic sine of x. Yeah? So these two combinations. It's just combination of e to the x, e to the minus x. Now, if you consider this solution, consider two terms separately. Y1 equal cosine hyperbolic of square root of g over lt. It is g. while cosine hyperbolic. So you see that it is a function such that for t negative it is grows when t decreases, well, t positive is also growth, has minimum at t equals 0. This looks like the following. We have this pendulum near this upright position. So for negative it's decreases just a minute. No, in our situation it is to the left. So for t negative our this pendulum moves in this direction toward the vertical position, but it reaches some minimal angle. So it starts from here, then it reaches some closest point, closest position to the vertical, and then goes back, because it does not reach zero. Zero is the vertical position. So our pendulum moves like this, then it stops for an instant and then goes back. If you consider this solution, y equal sine hyperbolic x, y2 equal sine hyperbolic square root of g divided by L t. Then you have other situation. Here it moves like this from this position, moves here, but it has larger velocity, and so when it approaches the vertical position, its velocity does not go to zero. Yes, it is still positive. So it has some momentum to go farther. And so it goes up with some decreasing velocity, then it reaches vertical position, and then goes farther and with acceleration. Yes, so it corresponds to the situation when its velocity is more than necessary to overcome this, I would say, hill. Go first uphill and then downhill. So this corresponds to this. Then we go this way and this. This corresponds to this situation. Yes, now I wanted to develop further both these both these situations on the phase plane. So we had a question M let me write x double dot plus g sine x divided by L equals 0. So this is exact equation for the pendulum. Somehow it is sometimes it's called equation of a physical pendulum because it's good for any amplitude. For small, in fact, for infinitesimally small, where you can linearize it, it is called mathematical pendulum. But I think let us call it, say, nonlinear pendulum or simply pendulum, and that is called linearized pendulum. So this is u prime of x. So u of x equals integral g sine x over L dx equals g L cosine x divided by L. Yeah? And so our energy function E of xv is, looking at this equation, v square over 2, just a minute, minus gl, yeah? Minus gl cosine x divided by L. Here v equals x dot. Now it's interesting. We have this function, and we have an interesting task how to sketch its level lines where it is constant along this line. So interesting points are x equals 0, x it is v, x equals pl, let's say 2 pi l minus pi l minus 2 pi l and so on. Interesting points. Now, let us first consider the values when x and v are small. If x and v are small, modul x and modul v, then E xv approximately, no, the first we should not approximate v square over 2. What is we have to restore that cosine of say s equal 1 minus s squared divided by 2. If you remember, the graph of cosine looks like this, and we are near this point. Yeah? And so, so this is minus gl 1 minus square of this, x square 2l square. So first of all, how to draw this curve, level curve, E of xl, v equals E capital. What is E capital? If x is 0, then it is minus gl. Yes? E xv approximately equal minus gl, it is this, plus v square over 2 plus minus and minus gives plus x square over 2l square. So for e equals 0, let me take different color. For e equals 0, you have and x for x equals 0 and v equals 0, this is equal minus gl. For all other x and v, this is positive, so it's more. So the minimal value of this function e small is minus gl. So if minus gl, so we have just this point. If it is a little larger, then you have if e capital minus gl plus some epsilon, then it cancels with this. You have v square over 2 plus x square over 2l square equals epsilon. Now it is a question of a small ellipse. We can find its semi-axis if you wish. So the picture is the following. It is a small ellipse like this. Yes. Now, if epsilon grows, e grows from minus gl up, then this curve becomes larger, and then we reach the position when what is at the point PL? At the point PL, cosine x divided by L. Cosine x divided by L equals plus 1. If just a minute, it is minus 1, but we have mean minus. Yes? So it is plus 1. So let me write it somewhere here. Yes, I need here. So for x minus PL and v small, we have the following. E x v approximately, the first goes as it is, v square divided by 2. Minus GL, and here is minus 1 plus x minus PL plus square 2L square. Yes? Because here the graph of cosine is like this. This is the point pi L. And here cosine is minus 1 plus what is written here equals V, let me write GL plus V square over 2 minus X minus PL square over 2 L square. No, X minus PL equals Y, so it is it is equal to GL plus V square over 2 minus Y square over 2 L square. Yes. So why is difference between X and pi L? How can you imagine this function? Now this is a constant. So for V equals 0 and Y equals 0, it is GL. So this is the point GL. And then the level lines will be the following. If the constant is exactly GL, then this is 0. V square over 2 minus Y square of 2 L square is 0. So it is then V is plus minus y divided by square root of y squared to L. Yes, so we have these two lines. If constant is a little more than GL, we have this hyperbola. If it is less, we have this hyperbola. Yes, and so the picture here will be like this. Now, this line, it is equal, energy equals GL, and here it is also equal GL. So they lie on the same line. Yes? And here we have, it is periodical. So this point is 3 pi L. And here we have a similar configuration, and so on, because everything is periodical. Now, if you go up, we'll have this. If you go down, we have this. So note that in this function E, this term is between minus GL and plus GL, because cosine is between minus 1 and plus 1. And this term can be arbitrarily high. It cannot be negative, but it can be arbitrarily high. So when it is more than GL, or less than minus GL, then it overcomes this term, and so these curves become open, they become unbounded, periodical unbounded curve. Here the trajectories are closed, these curves are closed, yeah, bounded. Here they are unbounded. And here we have intermediate case. I would like to draw them in other color. Let them be blue. Yes. Now, when the pendulum really moves, its corresponding point x and x of t and v of t moves along some of this curve. So when velocity is positive, it moves to the right, so the direction is like this. When it's negative, it moves to the left. So here also direction is like this, here direction is. So in the upper half plane for v positive, everything is moved to the right, and the lower half plane is moved to the left. And so what is the relation between these curves and the actual movement of the pendulum? Okay, let's look. If you take, say, this curve. So here the pendulum moves from left to right. Here it passes the lower position. Then it reaches the right limit of its motion. Its velocity becomes zero. It is turning point, and then it goes back. Here it goes from right to left. Now he reaches the left position, left limit position, and then goes to the right. Okay, so this is and the same for all these closed curves. By the way, the motion here, the motion here correspond to the same motion of the pendulum, because the angle or this coordinate along the pendulum, if you add to this coordinate 2 pi L, then you get the same point. Yes, it is the general situation when we deal with trigonometrical functions, that they are periodic. Yes, so this means that we can consider just one cell like this, and because all other cells describe the same motion. This motion is the following thing. If you give to the pendulum sufficiently high speed, then it reaches the upper position and goes farther. Yes, it does not bounce back. And so it would rotate all the time in one direction. So you see it goes right. So this means that it never turns back. Correspondingly here, velocity is negative, so it goes left, and again it rotates left and does not stop and go back. Yeah, so it is one type of motion, unbounded motion, say, this and this. So it does not go right and left, it all the time monotonically goes either clockwise or counterclockwise. Here it goes alternatively right and left, and this curve, which I once drew blue and now drew black, it is the curve which separates these two regimes. Yes, it is the curve where it goes, climbs close to the upright position, but it has no energy to overcome it. So it approaches closer and closer to the upright position, its speed goes to zero, and so it never reaches it, but never turns back. Yeah, so this trajectory is unique trajectory, which separates these two domains, two different regimes, regime of bouncing forth and back, and regime of monotone rotation left, counter or clockwise. And this is something which separates them, and therefore it's called separatrice. Separatrice, the curve which separates two different, I would say, regimes of motion. That's it. And all this picture, sometimes it's called cat's eyes. You know, our science differential equation is a source of beautiful pictures. It is one of them. So I like it very much. If you will study this further, you will see that this picture have very interesting ramifications and gives rise to immensely more complex pictures. So it is we are just on far entrance, far from entrance to this theory. Now, hopefully, we can talk about this sometime in the future. So now let me finish this example, and we'll continue next time with different subject. For now, have a good time. Bye.